Very good morning, everyone, and very warm welcome to the session. Right? So today it is one of a very, very important session for you. So this is going to be on the laws of ecology. So as far as this topic is concerned, it is one of the most high yielding topic, and many questions do come up from this subtopic. Right? This is Dr. Saranya. I am talking to you on a very important topic, and it is this laws of ecology. A little bit about me. I did my PhD in biomaterials, of course, after cracking NET, and I do have 13 papers of pretty good impact. I am into teaching for the past 10 years and research also before that, and I have guided so many students to enable them to crack. You can have a glance at my research work and publications here, and this is what I am going to teach up today. I am with an academy for a while, and I am helping you all to crack up your examination. Right, fine. Oh yes, good morning everybody, happy to meet you all back. Right, okay. So as far as these laws are considered, why do you require law? Yes, so let it be any law. Why do you require law? Number one, you are expected to obey this law, isn't it? Right. Yes, yes. Good, everyone. Good morning. Right. So you have to obey the law. Fine. So can there be outliners? Is there any possibility? Can there be any kind of outliners? Huh? Very rarely, isn't it? So in very rare cases, you will disobey the law. But it is expected that majority of you should obey this law. These outliners, they are accepted only in very few conditions, not always. Yes, in general you have to obey this law. That is why it is called as law. Fine. So before going into these laws, we will just have an understanding on your levels of organization. Right. So if at all you take any kind of region, okay, yes, so you are seeing a cat, right? So what is this cat? This is belonging to a particular species, isn't it? Right. So you call it as an individual, right? Okay. And then there are a group of cats. So what do you call them? Huh? So group of cats, it will become up like your population, right? So you call them as the population, right? And then there is the next level, that is what is called as community. So who will be present in that community? Only your cat? No. Who are all will be present? Maybe a dog, right? So you may see this cat, you might see a buffalo, right? So all the organisms put together, they will make up with your community. Fine. Next is the ecosystem. So what is this ecosystem? This ecosystem, this includes both your biotic as well as your abiotic component, right? So both put together, they make up your ecosystem. Yes, several ecosystems, like your terrestrial ecosystem. Can you state few examples of the ecosystem? Yes. Good morning, everyone. Come on. Yes. So can you state some examples of your ecosystem? Yes. What are the common ecosystem that you are aware of? Yes, everyone. Very good morning. Cheer up. Come on. So can you state few examples of this ecosystem? It is going to include up your terrestrial. Yes. Aquatic. Isn't it? Right. So you have a variety of ecosystem. So that is making up a biome. Right. Very good. Yes. Pond you have. Absolutely. So can you state few examples of biome? What kind of biome it is present? Huh? You have heard of this? Yes, everyone. Very good. Right. So it is going to be this tundra biome. Yes, Shikla. Come on. Right. So tundra biome. Absolutely. Then what is biome you remember? Biome. Tundra biome. Then what else you remember about this biome? absolutely. So you have a different regions of this biome. You have your hydrome. Okay, and what else are the biome that you commonly know up? So all these different biomes, they make up, yes? So you have your different biomes. You have your tropical region here. You have your Arctic region. You have your semi-tropical region. And all of them together, they make up your biome, right? And this biome, along with your total atmosphere, it is going to make up your biosphere. So these are the different levels of organization and our laws are applicable to them, right? So what are these different laws? Yes, okay, so shall we recap them? So before we go into the next slide, we will just recap them for one more time, right? So what is this level of organization? This level of organization, it is going to help you to understand how your total system is set up. Isn't it? Right. So coming to this first lower level, who is the lower level? It is your species. What do you mean by species? The species, it is going to be your individual. Right. And then, so coming to the next one. After species, which is going to come? Yes, everyone. After species, what is the second number? The species is going to make up your population. Right. Next, be ready with your answer. Next, after population, what does it come? Yes, after the population, you are going to get up with. Very good. Yes, Anisha. Next to population, you are going to get something. What is that? It is called as your community. Right. Very good. Yes, yes. Good morning, all. Right. Next, after community, you are going to get the next level. What is that? Community, it is going to make up. Very good. Yes, the next level is community. After community, you are going to get out with your ecosystem. Right. So this, still this community, we are speaking only about your biotic. Okay. In ecosystem only, you are going to take out both your biotic and abiotic. Yes, Tanushree. Good morning. Right. So next to this ecosystem, who is coming? Yes. After the ecosystem, you have your biome. Good. Next to the biome only, you are having your biosphere. Right. Okay. Fine. Yes. So these are all the different levels of organization. All right. I hope that this is all clear to you. Yes. Okay. So you have your biome is nothing but it is your community put together. Right. Yes. You call it as a rainforest biome. You call it as a tundra biome. Right. Okay. So these plants and these animals that live in this biome, they will have a common characteristics. Okay. Yes. So they are getting adapted. Okay. Fine. If you take a snow region, you can find this animal's characters will be similar. If you take up a desert, yes? So what is the difference? Will the organisms in the snow, they could have adapted in the same manner. Yes, what are the adaptation? Maybe, what is, yes, Agna. So what are the adaptation that is taking place in the snow region? Maybe the extremities will be short, right? If you take the desert, so these animals, they will have a very long appendix, right? So very long appendages, right? So imagine a camel, yes? So it will have a very long limb. Why it is having a long limb? Because it want to adapt itself to this environment, right? So if at all the animals, they are going to belong to the same climate, yes, they will have certain common characteristics. So that is why it is going to live together. Okay, so that is making up your biome. Yes, next, along with the earth, together with everything, it is going to form your biosphere. Right, so likewise, we do have these different branches of your ecology. Yes, so and we are going to have the various factors, right? So if you take up the factors majorly, you can divide them into two major factors. One, it is going to be this abiotic factor, and the other one, it is going to be your biotic factor. Right. So I'll just take one more slide. You will only tell me what is going to be the least of your abiotic factor. Shall we just try to list it out? Again, we will come back to the slide, but still, no, we will just list it out. What are the abiotic factors that commonly affect your environment? Come on, everybody, you can give me the list of the abiotic factors. Yes, abiotic, it refers to all those that are non-living. Okay, so what does it include? It includes your temperature. Very good. Then, what else? It includes light. Yes. Okay. Very good. Yes, Abbas. It includes your air. Good. Then, what are the other factors that is required? It includes soil. Very important. Soil. Yes. Very good. Yes, Tanishree. You require water. Absolutely. Yes. So, you require the temperature. You require the light. You require air. You require soil. You require water. So, everything is required for your growth. So, these are all called as your, yes, abiotic factor. Yeah, you require humidity. Very good. What else? That's it, you remember? So, humidity, your temperature, light, air, soil, water, right? Okay, this we are learning since your lower classes, isn't it? Right, okay. So, these are all called as your abiotic factors. Right. So, see, you require, sometimes you require your UV radiation such that these eggs will mature. And then salinity levels are there. And no exposure to air. Sometimes it may lead to oxidative stress also. Yes. And then you require temperature. Yes. Sometimes if there is no sunlight, that's all. Gone. Yes. No germination. Yes. And in this aquatic system, there may be your water current, right? So that is also one of the very important factor that is affecting them, right? And shall we just check out with the list of your biotic factors? Yes. So now we are done with the abiotic factor. Now we will do with the list of the biotic factors that is influencing growth. What are the biotic factors? Yes. What are the commonly used biotic factors? Biotic means it is all your living, no? So how a living being is going to influence the other one? Yes? The first point will come to your mind is the, which one? Your parasites. Okay, good. Then, if two living beings are together, what will happen? There is a competition. Yes, so you will compete with each other, isn't it? Right, so that should be a healthy competition. Good, okay. Then there may be predation. Yes, one will eat the other. There is a predation. What else is there? Mutualism. Yes, you give the notes to your friend gives you notes. Then it becomes a mutualism, right? You just take up your exam scenario only. So, you have your competition within your friends. You do have it? Yes? Alright. Fine. And then, what else? So, you have your commensalism. Right? Okay. What else? You have your mutualism, commensalism, duration, competition. Yes? Amensalism. Very good. You have your amensalism also. Right, amensalism, one is minus, one is zero. Isn't it? Good, good. Yes, everyone. That's great. Right, minus and zero. You have your commensalism. What is that commensalism? Any one example you can give me? One is plus, other is zero. A crow that is sitting on a buffalo. Right? So the crow will eat the insects, but buffalo is not home. Right? So one is zero, one is plus. Right, mutualism, both are plus. Predation, one is plus, other is minus. Competition, both are minus. Parasite, one is plus and one is minus. Yes? Okay, so these are all the different biotic factors. Yes, so they have your parasitism, they have the predation, they have your competition for food, we have a competition for space. Right, so what is the law behind this now? Can you find out? So, what are these? These are the different factors, right? Okay. So, if at all the factor is becoming limiting, yes? Okay. What will happen? If a factor is limiting, is there a possibility of a very smooth relationship? If you have an unlimited one, there won't be any competition. Agreed? Huh? So if I am having 100 books, right? So nobody will fight. I have only 20 students in my class. Okay? So these 20 students, they will take all these books. No fighting. I have 100 books. So everybody will get a chance of reading a book. Right? But if at all, my resource is limited. I have only 10 books and I am saying that for the tomorrow's exam, questions is going to come from this book, right? You have 20 students. So what you will do? Everyone will rush for that book. Yes, nowadays you are having e-book, so you don't worry on that. But still I am telling you, if at all that book is not available in this hard copy, then everybody will come and fight for that book. Yes, so when this competition, it is more. Yes, the competition will be more only if it is a limited resource, right? So if the competition is, if your resource is unlimited, then there is no competition. Okay, this is a very important point to be noted. Yes, absolutely. So whoever is fit, only they are going to win the show, isn't it? Right. So that is what it is, the very first law that is being given by Leibniz. Okay. So he gave this law of optimum, or he called it as your law of minimum. Okay. Right. So what he said, only there is a defined limit. Okay. So it is coming under the limited condition. Yes. Okay. So if at all, yes, you have the nutrients, right? Okay. For example, you just check out, you have a bacteria. Okay. So this bacteria, it is growing in the range of 30 to 37 degrees centigrade. All right. Fine. Now what you do, you keep this temperature as 42 degrees centigrade. Okay. Yes. So can this bacteria grow in this temperature? Can it grow very nicely in this temperature, 42 degrees centigrade? Can it grow? What will happen? You have increased the temperature so much. Okay. You have increased it to 42 degrees. Right? Huh. So it is little bit high for your bacteria. So will its growth yield be high? Will its growth yield be maximum at this temperature? Just think. So what I am saying is that, yes, I will repeat that for you. You just understand the concept, then it will be very easy for you. See, I have a range of temperature. Alright, fine. So this is my total range. Okay. So now what happens? This is going to be the optimal range. Okay. 30 to 37. This is going to be the optimal range of growth. Okay. But I am putting my bacteria at 50 degrees centigrade. Will it grow? Never. It will grow only if I give the optimum condition. Yes, you just think. You are seated in a room where you have sufficient lighting. Okay. Yes, then you will be very happy to read. Right. So you are sitting on a podium where all the focus lights are on you. Will it be comfortable? So for a few minutes you will be okay, and after that, you know how hard it is, while we conduct all your convocation and all. It will be really very terrible to stand on that much light. Yes? Why? It is excess. We cannot tolerate that much excess light. Our eyes will become dull. Yes? So we will pray that, oh my God, let the function get over as early as possible. We will quit the place only. Isn't it? Because too much of light will make you uncomfortable. Yes? So that is what this law of minimum, or you call it as the law of optimum, says. This is this Leibniz law of minimum or law of optimum. So what does this law of minimum or law of optimum says? We can be able to survive happily only in this optimum range. Yes. So instead of two lights, if they put all 10 lights around you, you will not be comfortable to speak. Yes. And also, if you are allowed to sit in a very dark room for a long time, yes, no mobile, nothing, you cannot survive there for a long time. Admitted. So that is why all these regions, extremities, you do not have a sustainability. You will sustain only in this optimal range. So when it is applied, whenever the resource is limited. Yes, yes, Petra. So this is your loss. So we are dealing with the laws of ecology. And this is the first law that we are studying. It is the law of minimum. All right. Yes, absolutely. So what is this law of minimum or law of your optimum says you? This is this Liebig's law. Right. Okay. So this Liebig states that your factor, it is having a very, very defined limits. Okay. Of positive effects. Right. So if at all you go beyond this limit, then it will not be fine. If you go, less than your normal, then also this sustainability, it is not there. So only this minimum range is affected, right? So this is what is called as the optimum region. All right, fine. So this region is called as the optimum region. So that is why he is saying that law of optimum. So below that, there is a suppressive effect. Yes. So this is, either below or above. It is leading to the suppression. Right. So after that, there is no life on it. All right. Fine. So this is what it is. It is illustrated here also. So you have your factor of intensity. Right. So if at all it is called as your power of endurance. Okay. Right. So this is the region for your optimal survival. All right. And after that optimal survival, you have the area of suppression, both sides. But there is one more law. What is that? It is called as your Shelford's law. Okay. Here it is optimum. So in this region, this growth is optimum. But I told you that there is one more law that is called as the Shelford's law. Do you remember what is Shelford telling you? Shelford's law, it is telling you about the law of tolerance. Yes. He is saying that maybe the growth is not optimum, but immediately it will not come to zero. Can you see the difference? Yes. Here, this percentage is maximum here. I agree. But in this range, in this area of suppression, it has not yet come to zero, isn't it? So your graph is not like this. Yes? So your graph is growing like this, isn't it? So this region, it is suppressed, I agree, but it is not yet come to zero. Got the point? But here it is going to be the optimum region. But below this optimum region, yes, there is a suppression. There is not complete arresting of growth. Only here there is the arresting, isn't it? Here only it is arrested. Before that, it is having a suppression. So this law is what is called as your Shelford's law. It is called as your Shelford's law of tolerance, right? So what is the Shelford's law of tolerance telling? He says that for any kind of your abiotic factor, your organism can have a tolerance range. Okay, so this is optimum, right? But after optimum, you have a tolerance range, isn't it? Right. So even till that, it can very smallly it can survive. Right. So that is what is called as the Shelford's law of tolerance. Right. After that, there is the zone of avoidance. Okay. So this is its Liebig region. It is this law of optimum. And this total region, it is your Shelford's law. So this is telling you about, oh yes, Samyajit, next class, tomorrow. You just click the subscribe button. You will be getting the notification. All right. Okay. So this next law, it is called as the law of tolerance. Shall we sum up these two laws? Very mild difference, isn't it? Almost it is the same. Okay. So this is all telling about your abiotic factors. All right. Fine. So now I am marking. You are going to tell me which law it is represented here. Right. Yes. Yeah. It is this law of minimum. Okay. Law of tolerance, right? Yes, Anmita, good morning. Next, it is your, okay, Bergman's, and D, it is Allen, right? So what is this graph representing? हाँ वेरी गुड, इट इज द लॉ ऑफ मिनिमम. ओके, सो दिस इज रिप्रेजेंटिंग व्हाट कंडीशन, ओनली द ऑप्टिमम कंडीशन, राइट. सो दैट इज व्हाट द लाइफ सस्टेनेबिलिटी, रिमेंबर द टर्म द सस्टेनेबिलिटी ऑफ लाइफ. यस, द सस्टेनेबिलिटी ऑफ द लाइफ, इट इज ऑप्टिमम. Yes, so at this concentration, this is the minimum requirement. Okay, right. I told you that in a room you want, yes, in a room you definitely need enough or optimal light. If the lightning is too much, like I told you, in this dais, yes, you cannot survive there for a long time. Yes, it will be very hard for you to read only after some time. See, think that you are on camera for a long time. How you will feel? Yes, too much lights focusing on you for a long time, how you will feel? You will feel some disturbance. Yes, so that is what it is given by this law of minimum. But it doesn't mean that you will not survive. You will be able to withstand, you will be resisting them for a while, you will be tolerating them, right? So that is called as the law of tolerance. You are able to withstand that for a while. Yes, it doesn't mean that the organism is going to die off immediately. It is going to withstand that condition for a while. That is called as your Shelford's law of tolerance. Got the difference between these two laws? Yes, yes. Then it could have been B. All right, fine. Now, so we have seen, a little bit about your abiotic factor and how these laws are ruling this abiotic factor. Right, so now we are going to see how your organism, it is going to adapt itself, yes, to survive under this condition. So to survive with your abiotic conditions, for example, you take the temperature. Yes, so how you are going to adapting, this adaptation is very wonderful in both your plants as well as the animals. As more laws are in animals, I'm just directly jumping into this animal part alone. All right, fine. Yes, so we will see what is about all these adaptations and come up about here. All right, fine, everybody, just a moment. Yes, yes, in a moment. Yes, okay. Sorry guys for the glitch, just a moment. Yes, okay, fine, fine. Right, so we will just begin with understanding on your different laws, okay, that are dependent on adaptation. Okay, so before going into that, shall we just recap what we have seen so far? Yes, we began with your levels of organization. So under the levels of organization, we did with what is a species, and then what is going to be a population, and then what is going to be your community. Yes, after community we saw what is going to be your ecosystem, right? And then we saw about your biome, and after the biome we saw about the biospheres, right? And who is determining all these levels of organization? It is going to be your biotic and abiotic factors, right? So under your biotic factor, we saw all this competition, predation, mutualisms, all those factors. Under abiotic, we saw about this temperature, soil, water, air, yes, and all your abiotic factors. These abiotic factors only, they rule us, isn't it? So how they rule us? They only set us with a resource. You have your limited resource as well as your unlimited resource. If at all your resource is going to get limited, you had followed this law of minimum, right? And then we studied about this law of tolerance, right? Oh yes, Nancy, very good morning. So we saw this law of tolerance. Now let us move into the next subtopic. It is your adaptation, especially with reference to your animal thing. Yes, so we have two terms. One is the adaptation and another one, it is the acclimatization. Okay, so due to COVID, what you are doing? Yes, on glitch of COVID, what you are doing? You are wearing a mask. Yes, you are very frequently subjecting yourself to sanitization. Yes. Right. So is this a permanent one or it is a temporary one? Yes, everybody. So is this a permanent one or it is a temporary one? So this is going to be absolutely a temporary one. So once this pandemic is gone, then what you will do? You will put the mask every day? No, isn't it? So it is all going to be the temporary one, right? And you are not going to make it permanent, and it is going into your evolution at all. It is a very temporary one. Yes. So who is determining this? Who is determining these changes? It is going to be your environment. Yes, Pavan. It is going to be your environment who is determining this, isn't it? Right. So it is a kind of your morphological adjustment. It is not going to give to the next generation. Then what will happen? Maybe we will have a mark here. Yes, our ears will become little bit changed. So if at all we are. Yes, Dibya. Good morning. So maybe we'll get a permanent mark if you are continuously using a mask. Maybe all our, if it is genetically determined, yes, then all our kids will have a mark on their face. Yes, so because we are continuously using that, and if it is going to, yes, Shiva Krishna, right? So it is not like that, isn't it? So it is just an acclimatization, or it is going to be a temporary arrangement. Yeah, true, no? Right, but these are all your morphological arrangements. So as your environment changes, again you will come back to your normal. So I think after 2 years, maybe you will not need all those stuff, isn't it? Right, yes. But what is an adaptation? This adaptation, it is like a permanent change. It is not a temporary change, but it is going to be a permanent change. So it becomes genetically determined. Yes, so that is paving way for your evolution, right? So have you seen all these African players, West Indian players, how they will be? They will be very short, So West Indies, African players, maybe if you have seen this cricket and all, you could have noted they are tall or short. Yes, they are tall or short. Come on. They will be very tall, isn't it? Yes, our Sachin Tendulkar, he will look very short, if he stand near them. Yes, why they are so tall? Yes, why they are so tall? Why so they are very tall? Because they are from very hot temperature. Yes, okay, so they are from the hot temperature, so they have adapted their structure to become tall. All right, so have you ever heard this story of this Snow White? Yes, Snow White, maybe when you are kids you could have heard that. Snow White and the dwarf, yes, have you heard that? Snow White and the dwarf, it will be having very very small fellows, Maybe it is a fantasy story, yes, but still all these Eskimos, they have the adaptation to become very short in nature. Yes, the seven dwarf story, you remember? Right, so they become very dwarf. Why so? Why these Africans are so tall and why these Eskimos are very dwarf? Is there something to do with the temperature? Yes, it is. See, whenever you go to the cold place, what will happen to your extremities? Have you ever checked it? Whenever you are in a cold place, what you tend to do by your own, you tend to rub your hands. Yes, you do that. You tend to rub your hands. You will put them on the fire. Yes, why? The extremities, they are the points where the heat is getting lost, isn't it? Right. So what happens is that if your extremities are very long, okay, then absolutely. So then what will happen? It will tend to lose heat fast, okay. But if it is going to be a very short region, yes, if it is going to be a very short region, there won't be much loss of heat, okay. So these are all come as an adaptation. So you give it to the next generation also. Okay, so that is the good example of adaptation. So now you got this example for what is an acclimatization and what is an adaptation. Yes, everyone? Absolutely. Right, right. Yes. So that is the major difference between your adaptation as well as your applications. Right. Yes, guys. I think there is something else. Okay. Oh, don't worry. Fine, everyone. All right. So likewise, as far as your plants are considered, okay, so they do have certain adaptation. So like how we have your adaptation, same way the plants, they also get adapted. See the think of the xerophytes. Yes, xerophytes, you remember about the cactus? Yes. And one more fellow which is very often used in all your beauty products, what is that? Yes, you have heard this, maybe girls may be aware of it. Yes, aloe vera. What is that aloe vera? Everything they put this aloe vera, isn't it? What is that? It is succulent. Yes. So aloe vera, what it is? It is storing something inside. So that jelly is only helping you to give a base for all your creams and all. Yes, moisturizer and all. So it is a succulent. It is going to, yes, this aloe vera, it is going to store the water inside. Okay. Yes. So it is succulent. And they all try to overcome the dryness, right? So all these succulent plants, they grow in these deserts. So it is a good example for the adaptation, right? So there may be physical dryness. Yes, there is no water. There may be physiological dryness. What do you mean by physiological dryness? Water is there, right? But it is too salty. So your plant cannot uptake that water. So that is what is called as your physiological dryness. All right, fine. So the good example for your xerophytes, your drought escaping plant, they escape even before your drought condition is coming. The good example is Arabidopsis thaliana. So this is what the genes are being taken out from this, and you put it into your rice, wheat and all, and you create your drought resistant plants. Right? Okay. So this Arabidopsis thaliana, it is an epimeral. They grow even ahead of your condition is coming. Next, you have your drought enduring plants. So what are these drought enduring plants? They are able to survive. They endure. They overcome. How? They store the water. Your cactus, aloe vera, they endure and they survive the condition. Yes. Next one, it is the drought resistant plant. This is what is needed. They adapt themselves to resist the dryness. Got it? What do? They adapt themselves to resist the dryness. Right. So you include this, includes this brittle bush. So these are all the good GM crops, right? So you can take the genes from these crops and put it into ours, then you will generate all this drought resistant, water resistant and all those things. Got it? Yes, drought tolerant plants, you create from all these things only. So these are all the good conditions for your adaptation. All right. So before going into the next law, your Bergman's, Allen's, as well as the Glauger's rule, we'll just have a look at the list of courses that is currently being enrolled. Yes. So on September 2nd, we have come up with a crash course for your DBT BET. And in this course, I'll be giving you the important topics like bioinformatics, and then I'll be dealing with the critical calculation parts that are very frequently asked up in your DBT BET. Along with that, we will revise small bio, cell bio, biochem, all those important concepts. I'll be taking for 15 days, and Devashish Kar, he will be taking for 15 days. So totally, it is a 30-day program where you will get the total crash revision for your DBT BET. Apart from that, I am conducting your regular batch course. Yes, for this month of September, I am going to take up with evolution. Right? Okay, so here I am going to take evolution. This class timing is at 4 p.m. This class I am taking at 12 to 1:30 p.m. Okay, and one more course I am conducting for this detailed course. Here I'm going to take it at 8 p.m. I'm covering the most important topic, that is the biochemistry. You can learn it very easily with me. Don't worry, biochemistry is this no more a threat. You can learn very easily. It is one of the most scorable topic, right? Okay, so in bet I'll be covering all these subtopics, so you need not worry on that. Yes, so you can enroll for this program and you can use my code Saranya Live. No Anisha, evolution, it is a separate course. Okay, evolution I am dealing it for your CCR NET 2020 batch, right? So for your DBT bet, so I am dealing with only this your RDNA tech, so your biochemistry, bioinformatics, biotech, mol bio, RDNA tech and techniques. Got it? Okay, two different courses are there, three courses I am continuing parallelly. All right, okay, you can use my code Saranya Live for discounts. Yes, so that will be helping you to gain a 10% off. All right, so coming back here, yes, so all these plants, they try to get themselves evolved, so they get adapted, right? So these are the good example for the succulents. Yes. Yes, 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 Anisha, I know. right. So these are all the succulents. So beautiful, no? Yes, they are the succulents. And these are the non-succulent plants. Okay, so they do not store anything inside. So these are the non-succulent xerophytes. Yes, fine. And these are all they give us, this ability to do with them. Right. Somehow my voice got recorded here. Yes, everyone. Just a minute. Okay. Fine, everyone. In a minute. Yes, all. Right. Okay. Sometimes. Right. It is shouting with me. All right, guys. In a moment. Fine. Okay. All right, guys. In a moment. Just hold for a minute. Okay, guys, I think it is fine now. All right, that's good. Fine. Okay, so coming back to our rules. Yes, so we are done with your plant. Now we will make a move into your animals. Right. Okay, so as far as these animals are considered, yes, we have this thermal adaptation. We were talking about that Snow White story. Yes. Okay, so you have two categories. One, it is the warm-blooded animal like us. Do we fluctuate our temperature? If you go to the cold region, that your temperature change. If you go to the hot region, yes, maybe you will feel the difference, but your temperature will be a constant one. Right? Yes. But in case of your poikilotherms, like your reptile, like your fish, what do? They are cold-blooded. They will keep on changing their temperature. Right. And next it is going to be with your endotherm and ectotherm. Yes. Endotherm means they produce your heat within, inside. Right. And ectotherm is they are going to obtain the heat from outside, that is from your environment. Why we should study this? Because these rules are applicable only to this endotherm. That is why we just wanted to study what is going to be these and all. Got this point? Yes? Why we have to study this? Because these rules are applicable only for your endotherms. Right. So this is a very majestic polar bear. The moment you see the bear, you get the energy. Isn't it? Right. But see, this bear is very sad. Yes? Okay, maybe it is looking sharply for some food or what. All right. Okay. So why this, what you can see this bear? This bear, what is the size? It is large or small? The size of the bear is large or small? Yes, everyone. This bear is very large in size, isn't it? Why it is large in size? Because it is in the cold region. If the size is big, then it can store the heat, isn't it? Yes, everyone. Yes, Abhirup. Yes, Dibya. They can store the heat, isn't it? So it is going to be like that. Yes. And what is going to be the surface area is to volume. Two components are there. One is the surface area, other is the volume. Okay. Usually what happens is that the surface area, it is going to be the spending of the money. Okay. So what is the volume? volume it is going to produce the money. Yes, so surface area it is going to spend the money. What is the money here? It is going to be your heat. All right, and what is the volume? It is going to earn the money, earn the heat. Now if your S bar V ratio it is going to be low, right, then it is quite good. No, you have to decrease the spending, then it is a good one, isn't it? If you increase your surface area, what will happen? If you increase the spending, can you run the lab or can you run your family if you keep on increasing the spending? No. So always the major key is you have to decrease the surface area. Got it? So you have to decrease the surface area is to volume ratio, right? Because I told you that volume is going to produce the heat, but surface area is dissipating that, right? So now let me explain this concept. Can you see a square here? Yes. So you have how many sides? You have your one side, right? And how many surfaces you have? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 underneath one. So you have totally 6 surfaces, right? So you have only one volume, one cube, no? So it is one volume. So what is that surface area is to volume ratio? Surface area is to volume. Your surface is going to be 6. Your volume is going to be just 1, right? So this is going to be the surface area is to volume ratio for this cube. Now you increase the size, right? So if you increase the size, so how many cubes are there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 cubes are there. Can you see it? Yes, you can see the 9 cubes. All right, that's good. You see a 9 cubes over there. Fine. So now what is going to be the surface? Surface is for 1 it is 6. Yes, so you have your 3 sides. So 3 power 2. So 3 power 2 is nothing but what? It is your 9, isn't it? I told you that there are 9. So 9 into 6. Yes, 9 into 6 is equal to 54. Got it? So you have your 6 and you have your 6 sides. I mean you have your 9 cubes now. So 9 into 6 become 54. So your surface area is 54. Right. So what is the volume now? 3 cube. Volume is always in cube. So it becomes 27. Right. So what is your SA bar V ratio? It is 2. Initially it was 6. So from 6 it has become 2. So what has happened to your surface area is to volume ratio? As your size increases, this surface area is to volume ratio decreases. Got it, everybody? This is a very important concept. Yes, so you will get definitely a part B based on this concept. Okay, if I am saying that your size is more, that means that your area is to volume, it is decreasing. Yes, very, very important concept. Now you understood this concept. Yes, everyone, this is clear now. All right. Yes, so as your size increases, your surface area is to volume decreases. Right, absolutely. So in case of your warmer region, you have your small animals. In case of your colder region, you have very, very large animals because you want to adapt yourself to the heat. So that is what this Bergman's rule is telling you. So what is this Bergman's rule telling? If at all they are in this cold region, can you see this polar bear? This is your country bear. See this poor country bear, very small. Yes, as their temperature increases or your latitude increases, what is this latitude? So this is your latitude, right? Because here in this tropic, it will be of high temperature, right? As this latitude increases, your temperature is going to get decrease. Got it, everyone? Yes, as your latitude increases, the temperature is going to decrease because here only you have your zero latitude. That is your equator. then it is going to increase in this latitude, right? Your temperature is going to decrease towards the pole. This concept is clear? All right. So this is your world now, right? So now what happens to the body size? The body size is more whenever it is in the colder region. Yes. And whenever they are in the warmer region, the body size is less. Why? Because of your S bar V ratio. Right. Next, the second rule, it is called as your Allen's rule. First rule is the Bergman's rule. Now it is going to be the Allen's rule. So what does this Allen's rule state? This Allen's rule states that your extremities, they lose the heat more rapidly. Why? Because they have a high surface ratio. So what they do to reduce the heat loss, they decrease your appendix, right? So that is why in your colder area, you can see that all the extremities, they include the ear, they include the tail, yes, they include the limbs. Can you see that? Yes, all these, it is going to decrease in the size. What are the extremities? Ear, limb, tail, yes, they all decrease in their size. Why? Because they want to minimize your exposure, they want to minimize your surface area. Got it? So always the concept is your surface area should be minimum. So you can increase the size, or you can, what you do with the extremities. In the extremities you are going to minimize them. Yes, everyone, this is all clear, right? So now we are done with your Bergman's rule as well as the Allen's rule, right? Okay, and one more rule is there. It is called as your Glauger's rule. So what is this Glauger's rule telling? Yes, okay, can you see this color? Can you see this color? All these warmer region animals, what color are they? They are brown in color, right? And what about this fellow, this rabbit, this fox, and our polar bear? They are white in color. Why they are white in color? Because Glauger says that the pigmentation, yes, the pigmentation, it is very less in the cold region, and it is pretty, more in your dark region, because this is also related to the heat, right? So we have studied three rules now: Bergman's rule, Allen's rule, as well as your Glauger's rule, right? One more rule is there. It is called as your Jordan's rule. So I used to ask the students to remember the Jordan River, okay? Yes. So in this Jordan rule, what it says, the fish of your cold water, okay? So the fish of the cold water will have more vertebra. Okay, same thing. This vertebra, it is representing the size only, isn't it? Right. So this fish of the cold water, they have your more vertebra, right? And what is about this wrench rule? This wrench rule states that this colder region birds, they have very, very narrow wings. Okay, what is the wrench rule telling? The colder region birds, oh yes, Akra Prabha, welcome. So it is going to have a very narrow wing, right? Okay, so shall we sum up all these rules together before we take up questions, right? Okay, number one. What was this Bergman's rule telling you about? Yes, Bergman's rule, Bergman's law, what it was telling about? So in the colder region, the size is going to be the maximum. Why? Because your surface area is to volume ratio should be minimum, right? Then only your heat can be conserved. It is a thermal adaptation. Next, it was your Allen's rule. So this Allen's rule is telling about your extremities, right? So how should be the extremities? The extremities should be short, dwarf, isn't it? In case of your colder region. And remember, all this law, it is applicable only for your endotherms, right? Okay. Then the third rule, it is going to be for your Glauger's rule. So this is for the pigmentation, right? So this is for your pigmentation, that is the Glauger's rule, Right. Next, coming to two more rule. One, it is the Jordan's rule. So Jordan's rule is applicable to the fishes. So what it says about the fishes? This cold water fish, it will have more vertebra. Okay. And then what about the fifth rule? It was your wrench rule. Yes, this wrench rule, it is going to be applicable for the birds. Yes, so it is going to, if it is going to be a cold, it will have a narrow wing, right? So if it is going to be a warm one, think of the eagle, it will have very wide wings. Got it? So these are the different laws. Apart from that, we saw about your law of minimum or law of optimum. This is this Leibig's law. And then we studied about your Shelford's law. So Shelford, it is going to be what law? Law of tolerance, right? So totally we have studied how many laws today? 7 laws we have studied. Yes, everyone, I hope that you remember all these laws. Yes, okay, so these are all very important for your examination, right? Fine. So can you see the difference between these two? So this is your colder region, fellow. So which law it is obeying? This first diagram from this colder region. What law it is obeying? Can you just type out in the chat box? Yes, everyone. Come on. So what laws it is obeying? The first one. Yes. It is obeying the Bergman's law. See the size. This is very lightweight. This is very hefty. Okay. What about the Allen's? Yes, see the tail. See the ear. This ear is long, no? This is looking like a dog only. Right, so Allen's rule. What about Glauger? This is very white in color. This is pigmented. Right? So all the three laws it is obeying. Am I right? Yes, everyone? Can you conclude that way? Yes, all these three laws are applicable. So you can see a wild contrast, you know, because of the climate. See, polar bear is also like that. So all the flock together, you know, it is looking alike, isn't it? All right. So this is your CSER net question. Okay, so we'll take this question. A general increase in this average body mass of your animal population within a species with latitude. What is this called as? A general increase in the body mass of your animal population within a species with the latitude. It is known as what? Is it the Allen rule, Bergman rule, Allek effect or Hamilton rule? Right. Which is the correct answer? Come on, everyone. Just now we have done it. Part B. 2 marks assured. Yes. Come on, guys. It is none other than your Bergman's rule. Body mass is nothing but your Bergman. Got it? Okay, very good. Right. And what about this question? Almost the same question. This is also a part B question from your CSER net. Yes, Pratisha. So individuals with greater mass, they have smaller surface area to volume ratio. This helps to conserve the heat. So what is this called as? Yes? Very good all. Come on, cheer up. Good. So this is also your Bergman's rule, isn't it? What is this Leibig's rule? It is the law of minimum. Right, what is this Glauger rule? Glauger rule, it is based on your pigmentation. Right, yes. And what is this Cope's rule? Cope's rule is something with evolution. Okay. What about your evolution? This is the size is increasing. Okay. In your years together. So that you understand only by the fossil fuels. They are not currently living. Cope's rule. Yes. It is not for the living organism. It is for the fossil record. Okay. Right, so it is not at all coming under our preview. We can eliminate it. So the correct answer is going to be the Bergman's rule. Yes, everybody. All right, so we have studied too much of laws today. So So keep revising, keep practicing, then you will be get a very good answer on your examination. All right, so keep studying, keep preparing yourself, and you can enroll for us if you are planning for a full term learning. Yes, so this is going to give you a class learn experience, right? So you can join me in the special class as well. So currently I am carrying out the special classes at 8:30 or 8:45 p.m. tonight. Okay, so you can enroll with all the courses and you can get the joy of learning. You can use my code SaranyaLive for 10% off. If you have doubts, you can reach. Alright guys, I will catch you up tomorrow. Yes, YouTube session, I have it at 10 a.m. right? And tonight, plus class at 8:45 p.m. Alright guys, take care and all the very best. Catch you soon in my next session. Bye-bye all.